I'm Natasha Kirchuk, and thanks for joining us from our studios in Israel. Coming up in today's newscast, Hamas and Egypt seem to be getting a lot closer. The French president condemns Israel, and we'll reveal which band is about to have the largest ever concert in the country. Stay tuned for the latest news in Israel. After years of border closures and a generally anti-Hamas attitude, it appears that Egyptian President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi is moving towards a reconciliation deal with the Gaza-based Islamist group. Recent meetings between Egyptian and Hamas officials have led to new security arrangements between Hamas and Egypt on the Gaza border, and that's not all. Hamas officials are lauding their new arrangements with Egypt, which could help the terror group with its electricity issues now that the Palestinian Authority has stopped paying their electric bill.
وما زيارات وفودنا المتتالية إلى مصر الشقيقة إلا تأكيدا على هذا المسعى. وقد وجدنا من الإخوة المسؤولين كل الاستعداد للعمل من أجل معالجة أزمات غزة. وصدرت الأوامر والتعليمات من الجهات الرسمية في مصر لتنفيذ حزمة من الإجراءات والسياسات وبدأ ذلك بدخول الوقود المصري إلى محطة توليد الكهرباء.
The signs of this new arrangement are already visible on the border.
الآن اتخذ قرار بتسوية هذه المنطقة وأن يكون هناك مجال للرؤية والمتابعة كذلك من قبل الأمن الوطني وكذلك من قبل الجانب المصري الآن سيتم وضع كاميرات وسيتم وضع أسلاك سائكة وسيتم تسوية هذه السواتر والأشجار الأشجار التي تمنع وتحد من رؤية الإخوة في الأمن الوطني حتى تتمكن قوة الأمن الوطني من أداء مهامها بشكل سهل.
But that's not all that's happening. We've been hearing rumors that Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas's former rival Mohammed Dahlan may return to the Gaza Strip and share control with Hamas. Some of his key allies have already entered the coastal territory. If this happens, it'll lower the already slight chances for the Palestinian Authority to take back the area. On June 16th of 2016, 23-year-old Israeli police sergeant Hadass Malka was stabbed to death in a terror attack in Jerusalem that shook the country. Now, almost a year after the incident, there are new reports claiming the attack could have been prevented. LTV's Aaron Porce joins me in the studio with more now. Aaron, what do they mean by preventable?
Well, unfortunately, much of the attack, the report shows that much of the attack and, in fact, the death of Sergeant Malka was largely preventable with a few simple steps that should have been taken that were on the books in terms of policy of the IDF and were not taken. So unfortunately, we're looking at a case of negligence, but I'll tell you more in the report.
According to the police investigation's preliminary report, it was operational and equipment shortcomings that played a major part in the outcome of the attack. Namely that, quote, "The tragic result of this attack was due to the failure in the force's deployment and the lack of personal armor," end quote. On June 16th, three Palestinian terrorists approached a group of six officers outside the Damascus Gate with intent to shoot and stab them. The makeshift firearm jammed, allowing the soldiers stationed there to respond and neutralize two of the three assailants, but the third ran away towards the Damascus Gate into the old city. That's when things took a turn. The soldiers stationed at the gate, which included the late Sergeant Malka, were supposed to be maintaining a 360-degree watch, but none were reportedly paying attention. In fact, their backs were all allegedly turned as the terrorist ran up behind them and proceeded to stab Malka to death. The final conclusion of the investigation is yet to come, but it's expected to be presented soon to police high command. In related news, a man suspected of transporting the three attackers has also been detained, and the IDF is already mapping the home of one of the terrorists in preparation for demolition.
The French President Emmanuel Macron met with Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas yesterday, and he has some strong criticism for Israeli colonialism. The two leaders met at the Elysee Palace in France, where they signed an agreement to establish a French-language high school in the Palestinian capital of Ramallah and agreed to organize a joint seminar over the next few months. Macron had some scathing words for Israel.
La solution des deux États, à laquelle il n'existe aucune alternative viable, est aujourd'hui mise en péril, sur le terrain bien sûr, mais peut-être encore davantage dans les esprits. Et les causes de cette érosion sont malheureusement connues. La France a toujours condamné et condamne la poursuite de la colonisation, qui est illégale au regard du droit international.
This is the first time that Macron has publicly spoken about his approach to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, although he has been opposed to unilaterally recognizing a Palestinian state. The French leader is widely seen as more pro-Israel than his predecessor François Hollande and has publicly taken a strong stance against BDS. France has held a pro-Arab line since the 1960s when then-leader Charles de Gaulle canceled arms sales to Israel and imposed an arms embargo. In 1969, Israeli naval commandos sailed several naval boats out of a French harbor that Israel had paid for and France had refused to deliver. In 2016, France voted for a UN Security Council resolution condemning Israeli settlements, including in Jerusalem. The French leader is expected to host Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu in Paris on July 16th for the 75th anniversary of the infamous Veldiv roundup of Parisian Jews during the Second World War. An Israeli soldier who shot and killed a terrorist in Hebron who had already been neutralized is now asking to be released from his imprisonment on an Israeli military base. But his actions are almost as divisive as they were when the shooting occurred over a year ago. In March of 2016, Elor Azaria was caught on camera shooting a disarmed Palestinian attacker in Hebron. He was sentenced to 18 months in military prison, but given that his army service ends on July 20th and his case is still being debated, it's unclear where he'll end up prior to serving his sentence. Azaria's lawyer is calling for Azaria to go home and at the most to go through house arrest every night from midnight to 6 in the morning until he receives his sentence. To some Israelis, Azaria's actions were illegal and disgraceful. Others feel that he was betrayed by the military leadership. Whatever happens, we can be sure of one thing: a lot of people will not be happy with the outcome. Israel is now moving forward with plans to build new housing units in various parts of East Jerusalem and the surrounding areas across the 1949 armistice lines, and it's causing a major uproar. ILTV correspondent Max Keisler has more details on the story. Now, Max, what has the response been from the United States?
We've seen a pretty weak response from the U.S., all things considered, especially compared to previous administrations. In 2016, when Israel announced the Amichai settlement, the Obama administration strongly condemned it, whereas now we're seeing language from the Trump administration about expressing concern over settlement construction, and yet at the same time saying that settlement freezes haven't advanced peace talks in the past.
So, in other words, you're saying that this is not necessarily condemnation.
I think it's ambiguous language. It doesn't read like a condemnation. If the U.S. wanted it to read like a condemnation, it would. And you know what? I'm sure Israel's getting that message.
Israel is set to approve 800 new homes in Jewish-populated areas of East Jerusalem and the surrounding areas, including Pisgah Ze'ev in the northeast and Gilo in the southwest. All these neighborhoods are considered settlements by much of the world, but Israel says they're an integral part of the country's capital. Israel's been holding back for years on building in Jerusalem, having faced heavy pressure from former U.S. President Barack Obama to refrain from construction in the area. But the response from President Donald Trump's administration is a lot more ambivalent. The statement says that President Trump has publicly and privately expresses concerns regarding settlements, but it adds that the administration recognizes that past demands for a settlement freeze have not helped advance peace talks. Israeli rightists will likely take this as a green light to build.
Basketball star Omri Kaspi has just signed a new contract with the Golden State Warriors, giving Israelis worldwide yet another reason to keep on cheering. But what lies ahead for Kaspi in the upcoming seasons, given all of the recent changes in his career? Joining me now in the studio to help answer those questions is basketball commentator Simi Rieger. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure, dear.
So let's begin. Do you think this was a good move for Kaspi to be making?
Yes and no. Omri had a very difficult season last year because he was hurt. He also had a coach that didn't like him. At the end of the season, he moved over to Minnesota, where the coach Tom Thibodeau really liked him, and I was sure he was going to continue there. He wants to go to Golden State. He hasn't been in a playoff yet. What surprised me, and I understand from his father, that he got the telephone call a minute after the free agency began.
Wow.
Which means that they had him in mind the whole time.
That's
he was a top thing, and that says a lot.
Mm-hmm.
He's taking a lot less money. than he's getting, but I guess it's worth it. And if he has a good year and he comes back with that ring that everybody wants, he can jumpstart his career again and get a big contract. If he would have had the same year as he had a year ago, he would be getting $10 million a year for 2 or 3 years.
But
that's part of life. It happens. And I'm very happy for him. And, you know, between me and you, as you're an American, there is a difference between Minneapolis and San Francisco.
No, absolutely. But, you know, this is the seventh time in 8 seasons that he's switched teams, right? He's been moving around a lot. I mean, do you think, in your opinion, as somebody who's been doing this for a while, is this too much moving around for him to really get the fullest out of any team that he's playing for?
Well, he was traded. It wasn't like he was a free agent and he moved on.
Right.
He was traded, so he has no control over. He was always under contract.
Right.
There's a big difference if you finish a contract and you move on. I think this is a very good move for him, basketball-wise, because the way that the Golden State plays is run and gun, a lot of three-point shooting, and that's his. And now you have to understand, Omri Kasbi is a great kid. I spoke to general managers, and I spoke to Hubie Brown, a good friend of mine who's the number one guy in the NBA on TV. And he says the coaches come an hour before the practice, Omri's already there shooting. They leave an hour after the practice, Omri's still shooting. He never hear about him getting a DUI.
Right.
You never hear about him hitting somebody. Never hear about him making trouble on the bench. He's a great kid. Part of that's his dad, Shimon.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that he understands what he's carrying with him. He's really representing the state of Israel as well when he's playing. And beyond that, obviously, he wants that championship. He wants it.
A lot of people are willing to give up the money at the end of their career. He's not at the end of his career.
Right.
I think he's coming into the prime of his career, which compared to Europe would be the 32, 33 is the end of the career. Here it's your prime. And I don't think he's 30 yet. And he's a great kid, and they like him. Everybody likes him wherever he's gone. He's never been a problem. And what can I tell you? I wish him the best. I hope he wins the championship.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you.
A lot more people will be listening to my stupidity in the morning.
Yeah, I mean, I think we all hope that a team that Omri Kasbi is on is going to win the championship. But the question is a championship on the horizon? What do you think? And also, I mean, I know he's now recovered from his thumb injury, but is that going to affect him in any way?
He recovered. He played the last month or 6 weeks of the season and did a good job with Minnesota. He wants a championship. I mean, it's very important. They're the favorites, by far the favorites, as it goes of now, because you never know what's happening, because now it's the free agency. There are rumors about Gasol going over to Boston. Marc Gasol, there are a lot of things that aren't finished yet, but right now they're heads-on favorites, and it's a great team, it's a great city, a good food,
absolutely.
And he's going to be a father in the next week or two.
Oh, that too. We have another thing to be celebrating.
That's
about.
Right, and because of him, you interview me.
Exactly. All right, well, thank you so much for coming in.
My pleasure.
All right, the 20th annual Maccabi Games are kicking off in Jerusalem tonight, and around 30,000 people will be at the opening ceremony. The Maccabi Games, known worldwide as the Jewish Olympics, draw athletes from 80 different countries across the world. This year, 10,000 athletes will compete, with over 1,000 of them coming from the United States, which holds the largest Jewish population in the diaspora. The largest event at the Games is, of course, soccer. 14% of the athletes in Jerusalem will be competing in the soccer competitions, whether in the youth category, the open tier, the Paralympic section, or the elite master's classification. The Maccabi Games stem from early Zionist ideology, and in particular the belief in muscular Judaism. That's the idea that Jews should prize physical fitness as a virtue. So I guess you could say that all of the hot beach bodies you see in Tel Aviv are a representation of Zionism. Here in Israel, Mizrahi, or traditional Middle Eastern and Mediterranean music, is very popular. But because the genre is typically sung, it's not always as accessible to foreign audiences as the artist would like it to be. Well, one Israeli artist is now bringing the sounds of the Middle East to life in her new instrumental album, Oriental Soul. Professional flute artist and self-proclaimed flute diva, Hefziba Zeraviv, joins us now to tell us more. Thank you. We love this. Yes, I mean, I love the sound of the flute anyhow, but I mean, you can hear the vibes of Mizrahi, Mediterranean Israel, and that, and I love it. It gives me chills.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I saw you getting excited over there, Aaron.
I did, I was.
All right, so let's begin. You know, tell us about your music. This type of flute music is not as common.
No, it's a new idea that came on my mind to mixture my roots. Actually, all my life I was playing classical music and world music and Irish music. But now I choose to come back to my the roots of my father and my mother. My mother born in Yemen and my father born in Algeria.
Wow.
And all these songs was the things that I was hearing at home. And I'm going to make a new project, a new album that will bring actually it's a tribute to the song that was very well known at the 70s and the 80s. Everybody loved these songs, and especially me. Mm-hmm. And it will be all around flutes. It will be instrumental.
Interesting. And are flutes the only instrument that are going to be part of it? Because I'm assuming you play other instruments as well.
I play other instruments, but the flute is so rich. I play over 30, 40 kinds of flutes.
Wow.
You can see in the video behind that
wow.
I play the Turkish ney, Arabic flutes, and classical flutes, and
that's
I know. I didn't even know that there are 30 or 40 different types of flutes. So that's amazing. Yeah. I mean, the flute is an instrument that I've always personally loved. I tried to play it when I was younger. Clearly, I haven't become professional, but I still can appreciate it. So I understand that, you know, for the album you're putting together, you have a crowdfunding page to
yeah,
raise money.
Right. Head Start
Project.
Yes.
Okay. And how can we access that?
You write Neshama Mizrahit, Hefti Bazer Aviv, my name.
Okay.
You just put my name is in Google and you reach me and you can write me.
Perfect.
And to get the contact.
Well, when is your next performance?
It will be next Saturday in Herzliya Park with Gil Shochat and Ptashka. So I will have the greatest pianist with me and accompany my flutes in
Beautiful.
The park.
Well, I think we should go and try to check this out.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're agreeing to go into too many concerts because there are so many amazing things happening this summer.
Right.
But I
this summer,
love what
but
you're doing.
In winter time, you are very much welcome to come into my house because I have another project that I'm bringing the audience to my home and playing a classical concert and having to know each other, to meet the artist,
I love
that. I meet the audience, and it's really wonderful.
Well, you know, Aaron's an artist, so maybe you could accompany your music with some art. Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, are you guys ready for the largest concert in Israel ever? Well, the Guns N' Roses are going to be in Tel Aviv later this month for their sold-out performance, and ILTV's Emmanuel Kadosh is here in the studio with more. So, Emmanuel, have you gotten your ticket yet?
I haven't, and I actually heard something a little sketchy about the ticket situation.
Ooh, what did you hear?
Yes, all close to 62,000 tickets were sold. It's sold out, but the promoter advised us to stay away from buying any tickets that weren't on Ticketmaster. So any international sites or anything on Facebook, it could be fake tickets.
Really?
Yes.
Interesting. Well, let's check out your report to see what else.
According to a statement by Bessel, some reports of fake tickets have already been made. He warns the public to stick to Ticketmaster only, adding that international sites and even Facebook was no good. The hard rock band that formed in 1985 have sold over 100 million records, making them ultimately one of the best-selling bands in history. And the show in Tel Aviv will be the final concert of the band's European tour, not in this lifetime. This isn't the first time Guns N' Roses visited Israel. Back in May 1993, the rock band came to Israel as part of their two-year world tour of their twin albums, Use Your Illusion 1 and 2. During that two-year tour is when the group started having issues with drug and alcohol abuse, but you know, 20 years later, thankfully everyone's back on track and rocking and rolling.
They definitely know how to rock and roll. Hopefully we'll get the chance to see so we can say we actually attended the biggest concert in Israel ourselves. But all right, friends, it's Thursday, which means it's time for our top five. For those of you who don't speak Hebrew and are coming to visit the Holy Land this summer, Emmanuel Kadosh is here to help us break down the top five Israeli expressions you'll need to help you out on your journey. Shall we begin, Emmanuel?
Yes, Chavar Azman, which is our first one, actually, which means shame about the time, literally translates out to be
right,
shame about the time, but it's the complete opposite. It means something was exciting and amazing and a must go to, basically.
Right, so you might think that Chaval al-Azman is essentially a reference to somebody wasting their time, like
right.
It's a waste of my time, but like you said, no, people here, it's actually very confusing when you first move here and
definitely.
You're trying to understand whether or not people are excited.
About a restaurant and they're like,
right.
Wow, that restaurant was Chaval al-Azman, and you're like, all right, so I'm not gonna go, it's a waste of my
it's
time.
It's a waste of my time, but no, when they say it was a waste of your time, what they mean to say is that it was amazing.
Must.
So if you hear somebody say, ze Chaval al-Azman, it means that you should definitely be headed
definitely
there.
Check that out.
Absolutely.
So, the second one is kapara alaych, which is actually kind of a funny one. It means atonement over you,
okay.
Which has nothing to do with the actual meaning of the word
right.
or the way it's used. It's used as a way of endearment, almost.
Yes,
like you can
absolutely.
Say something like kapara alaych, you were so cute, or
something.
To
a man you could say kapara alecha.
Alecha, yes, exactly. It was actually a reference to a Jewish ritual that they do on a holiday, Yom Kippur, where they take the chicken and swing it around the head.
Yes,
yes, swing it around your head. So whoever or
in
wherever,
order to help you atone for your sins.
Right,
that
exactly.
Is
where
it takes place.
Yes, kapara comes from, and then. So whoever invented this translation of endearing term is very...
referring to a very interesting ritual.
Yes.
So if somebody says kapara alecha or kapara alaych, they're complimenting you.
They're complimenting
you. And you should
you.
Be happy.
They like you.
All right, so our next word is freier. I see that's what you have
freier,
here.
Now,
freier,
yes.
Let's just say that if you call somebody a freier here in Israel, they're probably going to be offended.
Very upset, yeah.
Hopefully not too upset. I mean, if it's with a friend, then
right,
you know,
like you're
you can
joking
joke
around, kind of to show somebody like took advantage of you. Oh, you,
right.
you came out as a flyer.
So
like,
a flyer is basically like a loser. That's
right,
the best.
Right.
That's the easiest way to translate it, but it's not exactly loser.
No self-respecting Israeli would want somebody calling them a flyer
yeah.
or having.
It means like you get ripped off in the shuk. If you
right.
go to the market here and you're trying to buy somebody and they make you pay more than you should be paying. You would be a freier
exactly.
in that situation.
Exactly. So our fourth one is sof haderech, which literally turns out to the end of the road or the end of the way, which again, going back to our first one, chavar azman, it's kind of it sounds bad. It sounds as awful as someone's like stuck in the road and you have to go help them.
Yeah.
Sof haderech, but it's again, something that's really positive and really good. And
right.
the hamburger was sof haderech, you know?
Right. So again, like if you go to a restaurant, you really like the dish, you could say it was sof haderech. And it's kind of like, end of the road. So for there, it's like the best it could be. You've hit the top of the top. That's
yes.
kind of the best way to explain it in English. But yes, again, so for there. A very positive thing. Now, since we're basically kind of doing a elongated version of the Hebrew word of the day, let's make our fifth word our Hebrew word of the day.
Yala.
All right.
Enroll in eTeacher's online Hebrew courses and quickly discover that it creates the deepest connection to Israel that you could ever imagine.
All right, and now for our Hebrew word of the day. Have you ever been in a rush and found that your friends are just taking their sweet time to get ready? Well, here in Israel, all you've got to do is just yell out yala, which is Arabic for let's go or come on, but is used in Hebrew all of the time. So yala, Emmanuel.
Yala has to be one of the words I use the most often and in every situation. I do consider myself a very patient person, but I find myself saying yala a lot when I'm driving in the car or in a supermarket, so.
Yeah, absolutely. Everybody yelling yala. And the interesting thing is that it really is an Arabic word, but it's so
right.
popular here. I think it might be one of the most commonly
one of the most used
words in Israel. I mean, it's basically, if you're on the phone with your friend and you make a plan, at the end of the call, you could say, yala, let's go.
It means kind of like, come on, or let's go, kind of to...
Yeah.
to have somebody realize that you're in a rush,
right.
maybe.
Yeah,
you know?
But also it's a let's go. It's a form of excitement. So,
right.
like, what
let's
do you say?
Go.
Should we go and check out the weather yeah. right now?
Yala.
All right, let's take a look at the weather forecast. Then you should expect it to be partly cloudy with a low of 78 or 26 degrees Celsius. Over the weekend, the clouds are expected to clear, leaving us with nice sunny days and an average high of 86 or 30 degrees Celsius. All right, that's it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.51 shekels to the American dollar. Remember to sign up for our daily newsletter at ILTV.tv. I'm Natasha Kirchak, and thanks for watching.